Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Shop Talk, hosted by the Triangle Area SQL Server Users Group. So tonight, we have our regular cast of characters, for the most part. Directly over yonder, Mala Mahadevan. How you doing, Mala?
I'm doing very well, thank you. How's everybody doing?
Everybody's doing okay. Anders sounds like sleepy, having an interactive Sunday night, which I think means that he's now the kicker for the Jaguars. And directly that away, Mike Christensen. How you doing, Mike?
Hi, hi from the bunker.
As the former kicker of the Jaguars, how was life?
Very, very, very good. I'm a lefty.
950 miles in 26 hours unplanned. That's further than Jacksonville. 16 hours. Yeah, that's still further than Jacksonville.
Montreal, maybe?
So, Shop Talk. Every couple of weeks, we come in here, just a little after-work water cooler exercise, having a chat, talking about some data platform-related topics. You have questions. We probably have answers. And, oh, Milwaukee to Raleigh. Yeah, yeah, that weather incident was very interesting. About 1,800 flights canceled. So that's a whole story. We're not going to get it too far into here on Shop Talk, but I could see why you'd be a little irked about having to drive a quarter of the way across the country as a result of a couple thousand flights being canceled spontaneously. So before we get too far into this, if you do have questions, drop them here in chat. We'll do our best to answer them. I do want to talk about Pass Summit coming up pretty soon. It's coming up soon enough that I have to finish working on my talks for Pass Summit. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've totally finished them. I just have to make them polished is all. Yeah, that's what we're going with. And not that I am stretching as far as I can to try to get these done. Because actually, I do have one of them kind of done. I just have to record it. The other one, there's a process. There's a process, people. So Mala wanted to talk about a couple of precons in particular. The first one, because Tracy's not in here, let's drop a link to hers. This is Tracy Baggiano's Azure SQL Fundamentals, where it'll cover a variety of data platform options in Azure. So that is not just Azure SQL Database, also includes managed instances, it covers IaaS, and it gets into some of the troubleshooting options available for these platform products. Check that out. All of the proceeds for that particular pre-con go to charity.
Yes.
The Foster Family Alliance of North Carolina. Mm-hmm. And second link right here, Angela Henry is doing a one-day get started with Power BI pre-con. Right. So from zero to dashboard, which is probably better than from dashboard to zero. So I think that's probably the best route to do. The best part is that you could sign up for both of these pre-cons. Each one is $200 a piece. And Angela's is on Monday, Tracy's is on Tuesday, which means you could watch them back to back, just in case you need to learn about Power BI and Azure data platform technologies. Although I do say data platform technologies, and it doesn't include MySQL or Postgres, so maybe I should say SQL Server technologies in Azure.
If anyone needs more information, Kathy and I have interviewed all these, at least the female presenters, on YouTube, and I'll post a link to that. We talked quite a bit about what they plan to cover, and if you want to determine if that's the right fit for your needs. And there are a lot of very smart presenters, and there are precons that are free, so it's not going to be easy decision making.
Yep. So check out all of those precons. The links will get you back to them. I missed the Outlook dashboard, says Anders. So I don't remember Outlook dashboards. I do remember Lotus Notes. And I had a coworker at one of my first jobs where He was a Lotus Notes consultant and could do anything with Lotus Notes. It would be horrible. It would be an abomination, but he could do it with Lotus Notes. And so he had that love for Lotus Notes. He's like, you know, what if we could do this thing with Lotus Notes? Like, no. Please don't do that. Technically, you could do that, but please don't do that. Oh. So Anders doesn't want me using the L word.
The L word?
Lotus Notes. He says, don't swear. And I was going to say, I didn't say Oracle, but that might get me kicked off. So probably our biggest topic for tonight, Mike, you're fired. That is our biggest topic for tonight. Mike is now fired. The Jaguars do not want him as their kicker. And after seeing the Jaguars kicking experience, I could understand why. So our non-devs could use it. Yeah. So it sounds like, Mike, you've got some experience with Lotus Notes. Let's talk about that for a little bit.
So can you hear me?
Absolutely.
This is a weird delay thing. So I used to be kind of more of a business analyst and data analyst, and I would keep track of tickets in Lotus Notes because you didn't need to necessarily be a developer to create little databases. So it was useful from that, from a business perspective. And whereas, you know, you don't get to the keys of the database, especially in 2001 timeframe.
Pre-Excel days, I think it had its place before Excel came along.
Yeah, so that's Lotus 1-2-3.
I haven't used it very much, but I have had friends who've gone into it even as a career, like big time. Lotus Notes.
Yep. Now, the Excel days, that's Lotus 1-2-3, which that was a really good spreadsheet. You go back to the mid-80s, late 80s. 1-2-3 was a really good product. It was a legitimate Excel alternative.
Mm. Oh, okay. So I got it wrong. Okay.
Better than Google Sheets, I'll tell you that.
Sure.
But Lotus Notes was their email client and also apparently all-purpose application programming interface. Notes after they changed how it updated stored data. What's that, Mala?
Better or worse than Exchange? I don't miss Exchange.
The Domino servers, I'm not sure. I've never had to administer a Domino server, but the key difference here was with Lotus Notes, you had the email client, which was ugly. It was ugly, but it was functional. And then you had the ability to add plugins into their application. So you could open up Lotus Notes and you'd have apps that could be developed by third-party developers or by your development team at your organization and pushed out to employees who had Lotus Notes installed. Yikes, bad name. Domino's fall over. Soda mail servers, Mike. Soda mail servers. And Notes, after they changed how it updated the stored data, was not horrible. That's probably the kind thing to say about Lotus Notes. But yeah, early on, there were some issues around data corruption. Those were eventually fixed. And I'm not going to knock Lotus Notes too much. I mean, it's probably still an ugly interface. I haven't used it in a long time, but it's probably still ugly. I mean, IBM owns it. So now that I've trash-talked several giant organizations today, don't worry, it won't stop there. First Gen replicated the entire document to all copies. I mean, yeah, you're going to run out of disk space, but, you know, at least you won't have somebody accidentally deleting the one version and destroying everything. I suppose it depends. Do people send more emails or accidentally destroy more emails? That's a fair question. Also network bandwidth. Yeah. Well, that's where you get the token ring. So as long as you have the token, you control everything.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure that's how token ring worked. It is like King of the Hill. As long as you're King of the Hill, you control everything. You have the token, you control everything. Folks, by the way, if ever anybody asks about token ring topology, you successfully created a time machine back into the early 90s, and B, that is not how token ring worked. Think about when that was popular. Yeah. I mean, you're talking pre T1 bandwidth days. I get what you're laying down. I mean, I had Lotus Notes back in 2001 in college, and I could see problems with massive replication even on a fancy university server. So now we're going to talk about a topic with no contention at all, ORMs. So this was a blog post from Eric Darling a couple of weeks ago that we were going to include on Shop Talk, but you folks successfully filibustered me into not talking about it because we were talking so much about some other topic. If you want to know what that other topic was, go back and watch last edition of Shop Talk. All of these episodes are up at shoptalk.tripass.org, which you'll find a link eventually down here if you just keep watching. So Eric had this blog post asking, hey, do you know when it's time to switch a particular query from using an object relational mapper to using a stored procedure in SQL Server? So this is specific to SQL Server. Other data platform technologies, that fine line can be at a different place. But I think Eric does a really good job of laying out some of the criteria for this is when it's time to move. Anders says before development starts, and that's a perfectly reasonable answer. I will accept that as an answer. Solomon, meanwhile, my college was all token ring, OS2, IBM mainframes, PL1, COBOL, mainframe assembly, etc. And in fairness, at that time, those were, let's see, rough age estimation. They were, some of them were old, but, you know, universities, they're going to have some equipment. They'll have mainframes. Depending on the university, they may have courses that focused on some older technologies. Coincidentally, a giant insurance company, State Farm Insurance, I guess. I don't have to self-censor the names of companies here. We're going to trash talk them all tonight. Right down the street was all IBM and funded a lot of our computer science department. Oh, also, we had several RS6000s. And yet Solomon still turned out to be a productive member of society. I say that in jest. I mean, we had VAX. There was at least one VAX server at our university. There was some old stuff. Our assembler course was taught specifically on VAX, if I remember right. 92 to 96, so token ring was faster at that point. Yeah, it was a legitimate option at that point in time if you had the right hardware and you were in the right setting. A university where all of those servers are very close to each other physically was a pretty good option for token ring. No trash talking State Farm. I use them for car and home insurance. I will trash talk their commercials. They have one good commercial in 2012, and they have been milking that commercial for the last decade. The Jake from State Farm thing, the original Jake was actually a guy at State Farm who worked as an employee, and then they turned it into, I'm going to make an actor who will be Jake, and every commercial will involve Jake in weird situations, and it stopped being funny several years ago. And Aaron Rodgers can be funny. Aaron Rodgers has a very sarcastic sense of humor. If you can play on Aaron Rodgers' natural abilities, you get past the fact that he has the acting talent of a block of wood. He doesn't need much acting talent because he can throw to a Davante Adams all day, but you got to do better than that. Patrick Mahomes is a bit better. He has more charisma, so the commercials end up being not as bad, but they're still on a really stupid premise, and they've been doing that same premise for years. So State Farm, get better commercials. That's what I'm saying. I escaped COBOL, Solomon says, but did have to do PL1 and JCL. So I actually did have a half a semester where I had to do COBOL. And I think I got two programs to run successfully during that time.
So COBOL was my best learning experience, among my best learning experiences. It still makes me wonder, because you had to stand in line, at least the school I went to, you had to stand in line and you got 3 tries at the compiler to get it right.
3 tries?
Yeah, 3 tries and you're done. After that, so sort of a humbling experience, like writing code to print a page, literally like everything on a page.
Right.
And all of that, it really makes me somewhat humble and grateful at how far we have come, because that was a different era. Especially the thing with compiling limits, I don't know how people would take to that if it were there in any shape or form today.
Yeah, that the entire philosophy just inverted completely, because compilation time has gone down so much for the average developer.
Right.
At extreme situations, yeah, it's still, sorry, we can only compile this. We can only compile the Windows source code on a periodic basis. But for most projects, it's build, and at worst, you're talking 10 minutes. So that rapid discovery and quick error correction has, I think, been pretty good for developers on net. I'm going to respond to Red Nello's impugning of my character. If you know all the actors in State Farm commercials, someone has time on their hands. So the thing is that if you watch one NFL game, you will see the same commercials about 15 times. And that's the problem. That's, if it was a very broad set of commercials and you only saw it once a week or once every 2 or 3 weeks, okay, commercials, I wouldn't think much about them. But instead, nope, watching a broadcast, here's the 7th time I see the same commercial. Yes, I understand the gecko's not wearing clothing. Ha, that's funny. They're almost as bad as the announcers. And I'm not here for Matt Millen. So before we turn this into watch Kevin rant about football for an hour, let's see what we've got. Anders says, it's like doing a whiteboard coding at an interview every time you code. Yep. And if somebody tried to compile check your whiteboard code, that's a really bad thing to do in interviews, by the way. It's like, look, I'm not using my normal medium. I'm in a very stressful situation. I've got a bunch of people staring over me, and I'm trying to impress them while wearing clothes that I almost never wear. Probably not going to be at my best. So, okay. I forgot the semicolon. How is the Buffalo Bills predictor algorithm now? It is pegged on win, and it's doing a great job. It doesn't understand that week one happened. It's week one was preseason. So, okay, let's talk about ORMs. And Eric has this post, I think it was a really good post, on signs that, hey, maybe you should switch from using an ORM for this thing to using a procedure for this thing. And yeah, I'll be totally on board with Anders' position of don't use ORMs at all. I'm cool with that. I will not come in here and tell you should probably use an ORM. If you do use one by choice or by force, then with that in mind, there are certain queries, certain things that ORMs do absolutely horribly that a human does significantly better. And most modern ORMs of the Entity Framework or in Hibernate ilk will allow you to execute a stored procedure instead of doing the object creation. Really modern ones. So before I get too far into this, think of two different types of ORM. Think of the heavyweight, think of the lightweight. On the heavyweight side, that's where you're talking Entity Framework, it's where you're talking in Hibernate. Those are the ones that try to completely shelter the developer from thinking about SQL at all. And so they just write C# code or write Java code or write whatever language code they want and pretend that databases don't exist, that they're just a scary nightmare, and just don't look under your bed because that's where the database is. The other side, you've got the more lightweight side. Dapper is a really good example of this. And with Dapper, they explicitly lay out, look, databases exist, SQL code exists, and humans are generally going to write better SQL code than automated machines. Right. And seeing how bad some of the SQL code I've seen is, that's saying something. But with a tool like Dapper, you know, we're not necessarily talking about this, because there it's really easy to say, no, I'm not going to have to worry about when I switch over, because it'll be a pretty easy move over. With something that's more heavyweight, like an Entity Framework, this type of advice is going to be a lot better, because the process of switching from just using objects to building an object based on a stored procedure and using it is a little more work. It's still not a huge amount of work, but it's more effort. And it is okay for CRUD. Yeah, if you're using fairly simple insert, update, select, star types of statements for applications, then ORMs are going to be fine. If you're using very small amounts of data, ORMs are going to be fine. It's when you have complexity or when you have larger amounts of data that we start to see some of these cases where not everything should be created with this heavyweight process in mind. So Eric gives some examples like generating a long in list, and that's usually a really bad sign. Like I have this, say this memory resident set of objects that I want to search for in the database by their keys. So I've got 30 keys, and therefore the auto-generated code just creates an in statement and slaps them all in there. By the way, as a human, that's also a bad idea. It turns out that the optimizer is not very good at handling that, especially when you start getting into dozens or hundreds of values in that in clause. At that point, the optimizer is basically saying, you know what? If you're not going to give me good information, I'm not going to give you good response times. And that's when the passive aggressive switch turns on with the optimizer. And now it's working to spec as opposed to working for you. The next option that I really like is that you don't understand the query that it generates. So one of the things about ORMs is that as a developer, you think, oh, I don't have to understand any of this because it all just happens for me. And that is not a great solution. That is not going to work very well, because when a thing breaks, you're going to want to be able to fix it. Which actually leads me to a topic for later on tonight, so we'll keep that in mind. But you're going to want to understand, at the very minimum, what the thing is doing and how to troubleshoot that thing. The problem with some tools is that as you get more complicated object creations, what you'll end up with is an Entity Framework query that's like 10 pages of nested, unlabeled or quasi-labeled gibberish that has 8 layers of select inside a select inside a select and all kinds of strange ways of getting to the same answer, but that this is basically the way that the engine created this SQL probably makes a lot of sense if you wrote the engine, if you read the source code of the engine, where it's like, okay, pass 1, we're going to do this. Pass 2, we're going to do this. Pass 3, we'll do this. And if we just nest each one of those within a subquery, then we could do each one of these without having to try to combine them together. Well, what you can end up with is a query where the optimizer basically, again, says, fine, if you're not going to give me anything good to work with, I'm just gonna do exactly what you ask for, and you'll see how dumb it is. And that's where you'll end up in a case where I'm scanning the same 10 million row table 45 times because I had 45 layers of nesting, and somehow the optimizer thinks this is a good thing. It's sort of the same problem when I have views joining to views in which each of the views is a set of views joining to views in which each of the views is a set of views joining to views, and you have that nesting of terribleness, which leads the optimizer to just fine, give up. So in those sorts of situations, I mean, I think those are really good examples of when we want to say, all right, it's time to do something else. And the something else is usually stored procedures. I mean, I can understand we have very limited database development resources. We don't have enough people to create all of those queries. That, I think, could be an organizational problem. But supposing you're at an organization where it's a startup and you've only got one database person and a dozen developers. In that kind of scenario, yeah, the one database person may not have time to do a lot of this work. So trying to find ways to work through it makes a lot of sense. But as your applications get a little bit more challenging, as you have to join together more increasingly large data sets, you end up exposing some of the pain points of ORMs. And the solution to that is typically, let's take a step back, turn this into queries that the database engine can actually optimize, turn it into queries that the database engine can give us reasonable time on, and sometimes simply rewrite a query in a way that the ORM isn't going to, and get something that is technically equivalent in terms of outputs, but is significantly better in terms of performance. Anything you want to add to that, Mala or Mike? Before you do, Andrew says the answer, of course, is not to use relational databases. This message this message paid for by IBM.
So I haven't worked anywhere where I've seen ORMs work like used for just for the purpose they were intended for. I get that there is a place for that. Kevin, I think Grant Ritchie said the same thing when he visited us too, that he has seen places where it's used optimally. I haven't seen anything like that. That's why my experience with it have all nearly all been negative. So it's really hard to weigh in on the pros and cons of something when it is like that.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And it's fair to point out that in many places, yeah, there's a negative cost-benefit relationship. Solomon says, I think in the case of many small startups, it's zero DBAs, not one. That's true. This could be a small to medium startup. They've hired a DBA. Or they have a developer who has enough database skills that it's not terrible. But this is, I think, a case where, look, if you're not going to have people who specialize in a thing, I think it's important for you as a person to, you as a developer, you as a person who's instrumental in this thing, to at least know enough about it that you're not going to be embarrassing yourself, that you're not going to have embarrassingly bad code, and that it will at least work well enough to solve the problems at hand. So that, I don't think that's much of a hot take. I think that's a fairly lukewarm take, that if you have to be a generalist, then you've got to be generally good at things. You can't be a generalist and just be awful at, especially the data side of the world, where that data is going to be a lot more important than most other aspects of your application.
The cooler word is full stack.
Yes, yeah. And if you are that kind of developer, I mean, I get there's only so many hours in the day. There are only so many things that you can learn. And of course, you have to learn which is marginally most beneficial. So I do understand that time constraints are real. But I think
I've trained developers and I know developers who are good, decent at writing SQL. They're not on par with a very experienced data professional, but they can write decent code. Where Kevin and I work, we have developers like that who are pretty decent with their code. And I think that much of knowledge is good enough.
Yeah. And in a lot of companies, you're going to have developers who, again, you don't have to be extremely good at it. And you can bring in a person who is good at it and find probably significant problems. I mean, it's just the nature of the task that if you have somebody who specializes in a particular thing, they're going to have certain skills that you as a generalist will not.
Right.
And hopefully they'll come in and they'll find things. Otherwise, I question whether they're good specialists. But basically the point being that regardless, if you're going to be responsible for an activity, you know, you should at least try to have some capabilities in that area. You should have some knowledge, whether that be sufficient to go and do it on your own. Probably not. But in a lot of cases with developers, I get this feeling that, oh, SQL is hard. Databases are hard. I don't want to have to think about it. I want to just work in my programming language of choice and not have to think about it. And I understand, but I'm going to say that's wrong. And I think it's just as fair. If I go out and say I'm a full stack developer and you look at the UIs that I write, that's a fair point to say, you know, if you're a full stack developer, maybe you should try to write something that looks like it was made past 2001. And I'll say, look, you'll take my blink tag from my cold, dead hands. So Solomon says, so the devs do database work just like most web developers early on were Unix admins because they existed within the company, were in charge of the machine running the web server, and management didn't know the difference or didn't care. Hence, so much early web programming was done in Perl, which is for Unix admin work, not web functionality. Oh, yeah. Perl and CGI. Andrew says, it's not just startups or small companies that have no DBA. I was the first DBA ever for a company that had $3 billion revenue the first year I was there. And my first was to revoke the CIO's permissions in prod. Yeah. So in that case, my guess is this was probably a company that wasn't, say, data or network data driven or database driven, that it probably was more grounded in pre-internet lore. Insurance company. Yeah, that's so huge amounts of paperwork. I don't know how much database work they had at that point in time. Probably a fair amount considering they hired somebody, but probably just thought of it as, well, I mean, I gave the secretary the paperwork, so I'll give the secretary the database work. It's the same thing. That division was started in 1999. Look, pets.com, I don't know. I don't COBOL for Windows to hit SQL. So COBOL.net was really a thing. That was also around 1999. That's all I got for that topic. Fortunately, we have other topics. So I teased this a couple of times. That would have been advanced. Yeah, COBOL.net would have been advanced. It was one of the many .NET languages that Microsoft pushed early on. Look, the .NET framework, you can write .NET code in any language at all. They had their fake Java. I'm not talking C sharp either. They had, what was it, Visual J++, and then J. I think there was a J sharp for a moment. COBOL.NET, C sharp obviously, and F sharp came later on. It was a few years after that, but they had C and C++ for .NET. A whole slew of other languages, most of which we don't think about anymore because it kind of turned into VB.NET, C sharp, and F sharp. And all other languages, we're just gonna, they never existed. So, okay. I spent a little bit of time today talking about, hey, if you're a generalist, you should be able to understand what your code is doing, what the database is doing, what the UI is doing. You should have some understanding of how to troubleshoot to fix problems. And all of this just happens to fit in line really well with my next topic, which is involving right to repair. So on the 7th, Microsoft actually came out and basically said, okay, we're now on board with right to repair. And I'm dropping in a few links, one's from The Verge, one's from Ars Technica, one's from Paul Thrott. And where I got this from originally was actually a YouTube video from Lewis Rossman, who is very well known in the right to repair community. And this is a pretty interesting result. Basically, really simply, the concept of right to repair, you own a thing, you should be able to repair it. Or at least you should be able to hire a third-party organization not affiliated with the manufacturer to repair a thing for you. If you just have what the manufacturer gives you, then you run this risk that the manufacturer is going to say, oh, well, it's going to cost $1,000 to repair this thing, and the new one is going to be $1,100, so you might as well just buy the new one. When you could go and get it repaired for $100, $200 with somebody who doesn't have that incentive alignment structure to get you to buy the new thing rather than to fix the old thing. The underlying concept here is getting access to schema documents, getting access to how things are built, and getting the repair guides. If you go back far enough, and by go back far enough, I mean, we're talking even 20, 30 years ago in some fields, you could easily get schema repair guides. If you go back to the 30s and 40s with tractors, with the John Deere tractor, you actually got the repair guide in the original documentation for when you buy that tractor, which shows you, here's all the different parts, here are the part numbers, here's how it lays out, here's the basically all of the components you would need to know in order to repair this thing. It was explicitly marketed as, this is a tractor that you can repair yourself, which makes a lot of sense when you're out on a farm and it could take weeks for this tractor to get back to a John Deere factory. Today, it's a little bit easier, but you still have the same problems where, look, it may take me weeks. If I ship a laptop out, it might take weeks before that thing is repaired and sent back. If I ship a very expensive piece of equipment out, it may take weeks for repair to happen. And it took Congress, Mike says, it took Congress to allow car shops to get access to auto manufacturer info. So, yes. And what's really interesting about that, so that was, if I remember right, that was originally in the 70s, right? Because I remember being able to go to the library and get the auto guide for different makes and models of vehicles. So if I had an 85, whatever, I could go to the library, not the Blue Book, Shills. Yeah, Shills was one of the manufacturers, I think, but the one I was thinking of started with an F. Blue Book is for value of the cars. This was more of the repair guides, and I could go to the library, Mad Magazine, yeah. I could go to the library, I could get let's say I had a 92 Miata and I had an issue with it. I could go there, I could see it had all the specifications, it had the layouts, it showed, basically it was the full repair guide. If you were a repair shop, you could have one of these on hand. You could see what needs to happen in order to change a transmission, in order to do whatever. And those guides were also publicly available. There's some work that I don't think that I would personally want to try to do because I don't have the skills, the experience, or the tools to do it. But the idea that this information should be available, I think is really important. Yeah, timing belt, like fixing an ORM. Exactly, exactly. Or you say, I'm going to replace the timing belt with a belt from a washing machine because those are better. Then you have a specialist come in and explain why that's a bad idea. It's sort of tying it all back together. But this whole notion is, hey, I'm going to be able to fix these things that I have, and it won't just be a piece of junk that fails in 6 months and I have to go buy another piece of junk that fails in 6 months. If I have a washing machine, I want that thing to last for decades. If I have a fairly large capital expenditure, I don't want it to be throw it out in 3 years and get a new one. And in a lot of the electronics world, we've just become used to it, that is the way things are. And I think that's a really bad outcome. We have the extreme examples of, oh, if you open this, you violate your warranty, which, by the way, is not true. Pretty much any state in the U.S., if you open a machine, that doesn't violate the warranty. It's when you make a change which is itself destructive that you violate the warranty. But you see the little stickers, the scary looking stickers that say warranty void warranty void if torn or whatever. Generally not true. The stickers can say whatever they want. Doesn't make them accurate. But the seal, you modify it when you open it. Nope, seal doesn't. So the seal doesn't count. It's when you make a destructive change. I could cut that seal. Doesn't destroy the machine. So now we replace devices when a small circuit board or a chip is the issue. Yeah, and that's the problem. Where if I could replace one capacitor on a board and have everything just work fine, you know, there's a simple short to ground. Great, let's kill this capacitor, replace it with another capacitor of the same type, and have the thing work again for another 3 or 4 years. That type of change is a few dollars. If you know enough about circuit boards and electronics, then you could probably do it yourself. If you don't, you could pay $100 for a professional to do it and not have to buy another $1,000 laptop and be able to keep the one that you have going longer. So it's a little bit of a strike against the idea of planned obsolescence. Now, when you're out in the field, though, it is faster to replace the entire thing. Time is money. And I'm okay with that idea. I'm not saying, no, you shouldn't replace anything. What I am saying is that opportunity to choose based on what you want to do is better than being forced down one of the two paths. Solomon says, a few months ago, we upgraded our son's MacBook Pro from a 2012 to a 2018 model. By the way, Solomon, that's not an upgrade. Even used ones aren't cheap. No, they're not. For the 2012 model, I was able to upgrade the RAM and swap out the standard hard drive for a solid state drive myself. But now, the 2018 and newer models have the RAM and HD soldered to the motherboard. Yep. And there were certain variants of the MacBook Pro where the keyboard cable was so short that if you opened up the computer like a normal human would, you would actually tear that keyboard cable. So you had to sort of rotate it on its side and open it up carefully this way so that you could get just far enough so the keyboard cable is visible. Then you unplug it and then you could open it up all the way. But otherwise, you tear that very fine keyboard cable and good luck finding a keyboard ribbon, and good luck finding another one very easily. Check the prices for Nintendo Switch controllers. Oh, I don't even want to think about that. That's crazy town, price land. Same issue on my MacBook Pro 2013. Yeah, those. So it might have been 2013 that they introduced that, but 2013, 2015, somewhere in that range, that's when they made that switch. I believe there was a class action lawsuit about it, actually. So Andrew says the only farmers that are whining are the ones still running 4020s. Maybe. I don't know enough about farm equipment to know about that. But, you know, it just goes back to, I'm not saying everything, you have to retain everything for 50 years or something like that. Instead, it's more of open up the option, show the schematics, either make it publicly available, or if that's not reasonable, at the very least, allow repair shops to have the schematics. That's something that Apple explicitly does not do. And for those links, Microsoft is saying that they will. Now, saying that you will do something and actually doing something are two wildly different things, especially because Microsoft's saying in the year 2022, we will do something. But we'll see. We'll see what they actually do. Andrew says, I do believe the day an OEM quits supporting something, it should become available. Yeah, that whole notion of abandonware, that's the software equivalent of it. And I don't have much of a problem with that idea. Like, look, this is software that you're not going to support anymore. Why can I not have it? Why is it not available? And why is it not just there? Especially if it's something where there are license servers. So Adobe cut off some of their old license servers. And so Lysanki says, sorry I'm late, especially because you're talking right to repair today. EFS been fighting for this for decades. Yes, they have. They've been on the right side of this. DMCA, oh, yeah. But so Mike, the concept here was, this is related to a story from that Microsoft is saying that they're going to be pro right to repair on their hardware, which would mean the Surface Series and the Xbox line. We'll see, again, we'll see how much they actually comport to that. But I suppose I'll give them the benefit of the doubt on this, that look, they'll do something. I don't know if they'll do all of what I want them to do, but I'm okay with that. Yeah, like Mike says here, I'm for anything, no matter how small. Yes, because that's going to say, well, look, this company can do it, so why can't you do something similar? Why can't you make it available to make some specifications available to repair shops? And then, okay, you've made them available to repair shops. Well, how about you make them available to the general public? And even if some people mess stuff up, so what? It's kind of, this is your thing to mess up. If you want to take old laptops and try to understand how they work and you destroy a few along the way, that's okay. If they're your laptop, I mean, if they're somebody else's laptops, okay, don't do that. But this is a thing that you own. This is your property. This isn't a thing that you've leased from an organization. So Anders has said, a Corvette C5 is a good example. There's one piece that fails and it'll leave the car inoperable. Automotive complexity is real. I mean, I'm not saying your shade tree mechanic is going to be able to diagnose modern problems with computers on automobiles. Some of that is very complex work. But I also don't think this is some magical stuff that can only happen at the manufacturer or one of the organizations that the manufacturer deems is available to perform repair. Like, okay, if you can train them, then you could give that same training to the people who do it independently. Even if that's, oh yeah, you can pay for this training. Some people will, some people won't. And information still becomes available. If you make the specification sheets available, then that's going to be good enough in a lot of cases. So Mike says, a certain many fear we discover their back doors. Maybe. Maybe. I say maybe because it's hard to find back doors even when you're looking. Ask the SSH project. Solomon says, Solomon links to a good Lewis Rossman video about Adobe software works better when pirated. Yeah, that's what I was referencing, that they shut down the key servers on several of their older versions of things like Adobe Premiere, which, okay, yeah, that software is 10 to 12 years old at this point, so I understand you're not getting more money from it, but at that point, why do you have to shut down the key server? Like, why not just say, here's a final patch that unlocks and no longer requires a key server. And if that's so difficult, try to do something to make it so that the people who have bought your software can still use it. If you're using software from 2009, yeah, I could probably make fun of it. We make fun of people running SQL Server 2008 after all, but there can be reasons that I choose to use this particular version, or I need to use this particular version for a certain thing. I mean, this is where if I may make fun of companies running SQL Server 2000, but if the servers just stopped because, oh, well, we shut it off, people shouldn't use 2000 anymore, it's not supported, then you have a problem. So, only reason they can't build cars right now is a lack of chips. There were zero chips in cars in the 70s. Yes, but you know, there were also no catalytic converters until the mid to late 70s. And as we all know, the catalytic converter is when cars started to die. I forget what movie reference that was from. Like, no car with a catalytic converter can beat this baby. But all computers, TVs, lots of these things phone home, and especially smartphones do. Pretty much anything IoT is constantly phoning home. It's part of why I don't like IoT in the home very much. And I also don't like smart TVs because they're pretty stupid. I would rather have a dumb TV that actually does its job as a television and then have a pluggable hardware component like a Roku device that actually can do the job of displaying things like YouTube without having to update itself every 2 days, and also without seemingly failing on a regular basis, like most televisions do. So Raymond says this is where patents come in. Yeah, patents, you can still, actually, let me say this. With a patent, in order to patent something, you have to make the specification available because you're patenting a process. So the process of doing X, yes, I own a patent on that. But in order to get the patent on it, I have to explain what the process is to some level of specification. And then that patent is an open book. Anybody can review the patent. Now, the tricky part is that, the tricky part is that you have an organization like a Microsoft and Amazon and Apple who will patent a thing as well as the half a dozen other variants of the thing, trying to basically scattershot, collect all the possibilities of how you could implement this. But, you know, those patent diagrams tend to be pretty expressive, and they're not schema diagrams. They're not going to be that high quality. And the particular implementation can change. It can vary based on how broad the patent is. But when you're talking about hardware in particular, the patent organization has historically been required you to be very specific about the method and process by which you're performing an operation before they'll grant you a patent. Software has been a little bit more of an open story where you know, famously, Amazon had one click, that they patented one click to buy a thing, which meant that for a long time, everybody else had to do two clicks to buy a thing because Amazon had one click. So that has been an issue, and it's an unrelated issue, but also just kind of gets to the whole process is difficult. And that's where I think the choice which increases the available number of options is generally going to be the choice which is better. Maybe not always. I don't think I'm, since I just threw that off the top of my head, I'm not going to make that the hill that I want to die on. But I think that it's at least it's a good starting point. So checking out chat here. Solomon suggested in a comment that they offer a patch to bypass the key server, as I just mentioned. Yeah. Doesn't matter the reason for running an older version, it's their legal right. Exactly. I bought this software. I own this software. I own this copy of this software that I can use to these extents. End user license agreements get a little funky, but then there's the dirty secret that a lot of stuff in end user license agreements is unenforceable legally. And if they went to court on some of these things, depending on the jurisdiction, there are certain courts which will just green light. Oh, okay. Yep. It's in the EULA. So you have to give your firstborn away. You agreed to it by clicking this button where after you bought the software that you paid for with your money, you clicked the button that said, yep, I'll give my firstborn child away. And so there are judges who will embrace the absurdity, but in a lot of cases, there's a reason there are severability clauses in EULAs. It's because if you go to court on a specific thing, most likely that thing is unenforceable. Trying to sell us a new start menu is a reason to upgrade to Windows 11. Well, actually, I think my bigger problem is not so much there's a new start menu, it's that I can't get my clock on each monitor. That's a thing that's going to keep me from Windows 11 for a while. It is not necessary for IoT to phone home unless home is the owner's edge. Yeah, no, I agree. I think well-designed IoT devices don't constantly have to go out to the internet for everything. Most IoT devices are not well-designed. Ah, yeah, Solomon, that's what it was. It was from the Blues Brothers. The opening scene, Elwood is justifying his purchase of a used cop car. That's right, because catalytic converters have been acquired since the mid-1970s, like I said, Anders. Let's see. Lysanke, Mike says, patents will only help big companies continue to suppress little ones. And yes, I worked for IBM and created a bunch of IP for them. I mean, that's what patents have turned into, that you hear about patent walls and patent defenses and offensive patents. And generally what ends up happening is that you have all of these different patents. And actually the giant companies buying companies specifically for their patents. And then what'll happen is they'll kind of grant each other cross use so that they don't sue each other constantly. So FAMG will, kind of trade off their patents with each other. Like, yeah, you can use ours and we'll use yours and we don't have to worry about any of this stuff. Microsoft doing this just means one thing. They have a plan for all software to be rented. Ah, well, given that this is hardware they're talking about, not software, maybe onto something. But considering all the hype that Microsoft has put into Azure, into the cloud. Yeah, that's software as a rental. It's mainframe as a service. Courts have in many cases dismissed EULAs. Exactly. You can't just put whatever you want, put it behind a click and say, well, yeah, obviously you agreed to all of this. Nope. You have to follow the rubric of established law within the area. And also, in some cases, just the fact that you have this EULA here. I think if I remember right, there were a couple of judicial cases. I don't remember how well they went down, but cases where it was basically the mechanism by which you expose the EULA is itself not legal. And therefore, everything within the EULA is irrelevant. That you can't, after a person has purchased this thing, then coerce the terms of service for use of the thing. I think there were a couple of cases that ended up down that road, but that's definitely not the common option. That's not what we usually see. Can't you just create an app to get your clock everywhere? So you maybe you could, yes. Definitely you could. There are third-party solutions for it. But the fact that this was a thing that has been in Windows for decades, literally decades. I mean, multi-monitor support where you see the clock on each taskbar has been around since at the very least Windows XP. And might have been in Windows 2000, but I didn't have enough monitors at that point in time. So at that point, you say, this thing has been here for decades. Why is it not here now? Pharma and biotech do this as well. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Patent trolling is for real. Blues Brothers is one of the greatest movies of all time. Yes. And Andrew says, so no taskbar on each monitor at all? So you can get a taskbar, but what you can't get is to say, show my clock on each taskbar, on each monitor. You can only show it on the primary monitor in Windows 11.
Can you get Windows 11 to look at the XP registration keys?
I have no idea.
That was a terrible joke.
Oh, well, there we go.
It was there since XP.
There we go. That was... Mike with the terrible jokes to lead us out. If we didn't let programmers make changes, there wouldn't be any bugs to be fixed, maybe.
Cold call. Yeah.
Don't worry. I'm sure developers make bugs on their first try as well. They don't have to introduce them later as patches. Here's your new month of bugs. So, all right. We are at the top of the hour. Thank you, everybody. Some very interesting discussion, Right to Repair. Do check that out. Had some links in here and be interested to see with Microsoft making that announcement. We'll see if any other companies end up following suit. Hopefully, we'll see some organizations that will make at least tentative steps. Ideally, some make some realistic steps, but fingers are crossed on that. In the meantime, I want to say, everybody, have a wonderful night. Real briefly, we will not have our meeting tomorrow night. So had a last minute, unfortunate cancellation. So we're not going to be able to host Frank Gill tomorrow night. We will have Randolph West next Tuesday, and we'll have Matt Gordon on Tuesday the 25th. And then we'll try to schedule Frank back in later on at some point when it all works out. In the meantime, everyone, have a wonderful night, and we'll see you next Tuesday.
Bye.